Okay, good evening and welcome to the February Speakers Night for the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada, Toronto Centre. I'm the president and the host for the evening, Ralph Chu, and I'm glad to see everybody here tonight. We have a really special presentation tonight looking at the 40th anniversary coming up very soon of one of our biggest expeditions to see a solar eclipse in recent time. And for that purpose, I'm going to turn the floor over to Randy Attwood, the executive director of the RASC, who is also involved with the organization of the expedition. So Randy, take it away.
Thanks, Ralph. I definitely had nothing to do with the organization. I was finishing up a university program in London at the time, so I think I must have been a London Centre member. But I am a past president of the Toronto Centre, and I met many of my friends of the Toronto Centre at this eclipse, Michael, and I'd known Ralph from the 72 eclipse, which we'll talk a little bit about tonight. But this this eclipse that you're going to hear about tonight was quite unique. I'm not sure something like this could be done today, and you'll see why during Michael's presentation, primarily all of the aviation laws that were broken during that particular expedition. I'll leave it there. But, you know, after the 2017 eclipse, where 100 million people saw the corona in the United States, there is just an incredible demand today for expeditions to see eclipses such as the one this year in South America. Back in the 1970s, there were very few, if any, organized expeditions run by travel agencies. They really started, well, there was one in 73, I believe, for the long eclipse that went through Africa. But it really wasn't until the 80s and 90s that these organized trips popped up in Sky and Telescope and Astronomy magazine. So this was a big risk and a big project for the Toronto Centre. And Michael Watson, who organized that trip, is going to be presenting first today. And I approached Michael about a year ago about this, about, you know, hey, the 40th anniversary is coming up. Don't you feel old? You look not too bad, but how do you feel? But I also thought it'd be a great time to reminisce. And I knew that Michael, we pulled out the old files and found information about the trip. But the amazing thing about the trip was that after the eclipse, several members of the Toronto Centre put together a slide presentation, which really captured not only the people, but also the sense of what it was like to be there. So Michael is going to reminisce about this expedition, but he's going to preview it with some expeditions and important eclipses in the 100 years before 1979. And then I'm going to not show you the slideshow, because that would take three slide projectors, and it was all very manual, and it was pretty crazy to run. But what I did in the last 4 years was take the slides and take the audio track and essentially put it to video. And it was an interesting experiment or adventure for me, because I learned how to, I'd done a lot of editing when we had our, you know, our Toronto Centre cable TV show in the 80s, but I had not done it properly on a laptop. So this was kind of fun to do, because the way it was before, the three slide trays, you just couldn't present it to a group of people here tonight. But now the Toronto Centre will have an archival version of this, and I hope you'll enjoy that. But first, what I'd like to do is introduce Michael, who's going to talk about Flight into Totality and preview the 1979 trip with some presentations and talks about other eclipses that led up to this important trip. So Michael Watson, unattached member of the RASC, board member, and a very good friend. And the, I don't know how many eclipses did we figure out we were on together, six or so. So I'll pass it on to Michael right now.
So thank you, Randy, and thank you, Ralph. It's always nice to be back at the Toronto Centre. I was a Toronto Centre member for a long time. I joined the RASC in 1970, believe it or not, so I'm coming up to my next year, to my 50th anniversary as a member of the Society. And pretty early on in my sort of career as an amateur astronomer at the end of high school, I became intrigued with solar eclipses, and obviously at that time I had not seen one. And you know, since that time, a number of us here, Randy and certainly Ralph too, the president, and I have seen many around the world. But as Randy said, you know, at that time, the solar eclipse expeditions were really not commercial enterprises. And I think most people here are aware of the fact that there is, on average, one total eclipse of the sun that is visible someplace on planet Earth about every 18 months. Now, people think that they're incredibly rare. What are you talking about, 18 months? But the paths within which the total phase of a solar eclipse can be seen are very narrow, and they range you know, anywhere from just, you know, a few dozens of kilometers wide to a few hundred kilometers wide up in the polar regions. But where they cross the temperate zones, they're usually on the order of 100 or 150 kilometers wide, these very narrow paths. And as a result, any one place on Earth's surface sees a total solar eclipse only about once every... Well, the traditional number is given, which is actually isn't quite right. It's about 360 years. It's actually more like about 340, a little more frequently in the Northern Hemisphere than in the Southern Hemisphere. Won't get into that. But you got to stay in one spot for a long time to see a total solar eclipse, many lifetimes. And that's why people have to travel long distances to situate themselves within what we call the path of totality for a total solar eclipse. And we got to travel long distances, and we have, to many countries around the world, and we'll talk about some of that, and you'll see some of the charts. Many of you will be solar eclipse fanatics. If you've seen one, you certainly do become a fanatic. And this then is the story with some background, as Randy said, leading up to it, of the 1979 eclipse. And this is 40 years later, and the Toronto Centre RASC Total Solar Eclipse Expedition. So, and that was the date. It's a date that is certainly etched in my mind, February 26th. And when we were doing this, I thought that it would be sort of helpful and useful and interesting to talk a little bit about historical eclipses. And as Randy said, back you know, in the 100 years or so before the 1970s, certainly solar eclipses had been seen by accident for, you know, tens of thousands of years. And then you know, modern predictions started to come to the fore, where they could be predicted reasonably accurately in the 1700s and 1800s, and of course extremely accurate now. So when we go back in time, and I want to start with this one, which is an interesting one, back in the 1870s. So this was almost exactly one century before the Toronto Centre expedition in 1979. This was a July one, nice weather compared with February. And so here was the path of totality, and you can see then that some part of the entire eclipse can be seen within the region bounded by green. So that was the area on Earth's surface within which everybody could see a partial eclipse, if the weather was good. But the total eclipse could be seen only within the narrow path bounded by the blue lines. And you'll see that the path crossed Western Canada and then down into Wyoming. It's actually really interesting. In the last 100 years or so, there have been three total eclipses that have crossed Wyoming. And of course, one of them was August of 2017, a year and a half ago. That's one of the reasons that I chose this. But this was an interesting expedition. At that time, the predictions for solar eclipses were published only months before the actual event, because only then did they have the observations and so on from which they could produce reasonable predictions as to where exactly the boundaries of the path of totality would be. And so the U.S. Naval Observatory in Washington, which always produced these eclipse bulletins, produced this, as you can see at the very bottom, in 1878, early in 1878, so just barely with half a year of preparation time. And it was interesting. This is the Henry Draper expedition. Henry Draper was a well-known astronomer and did star cataloging and so on. The Draper catalog is well-known. Congress at that time, the Republicans and Democrats managed to get together to vote on something together. And what they did is they voted for, I think the figure was something like $3,600 to fund scientists from the East Coast to travel to Colorado, number one, just outside Denver near Colorado Springs, and number two, to Wyoming to observe and study the solar eclipse. And Simon Newcomb went to a well-known astronomer who was born, by the way, in Canada and then became the head of the U.S. Naval Observatory, went to Colorado, and Henry Draper had an expedition to Wyoming. And here you see them all dressed up in their proper eclipse duds, very formal. And one of the interesting people at this one was Thomas Edison. Now, Thomas Edison had developed a little machine to measure certain radiation coming from the sun. And the story is that what he did is he to keep out of the dust and all of that, he set up his equipment in an abandoned chicken coop for the eclipse. What he didn't realize, probably because it was his first eclipse, is that when it started to get dark, the chickens came home to roost and totally wrecked up messed up his experiment. So it was useless. And from then on, we know that you do not observe from a chicken coop. And we haven't in any eclipses that I've been on since that time. So that was an interesting eclipse. We then get to 1922. And I need to give a bit of a background to this. This was a very scientifically important eclipse. In the early 1900s, in the Swiss Patent Office, there was a nondescript fellow whose last name was Einstein. And he worked there for some time and then went on to bigger and better things. And over the course of the next decade or so, he decided that he would come up with a theory, which ultimately he called and published in 1915 as the general theory of relativity. Up until that time, the model for that explained the orbits of planets around the sun and moons around planets and so on was the Newtonian gravitational model. And that presupposed that massive bodies exerted a force, which we call gravity, and we still call gravity today, an attractive force that diminishes the square of the distance between the two bodies. And that's what kept everything in orbit. Einstein had a different theory. His theory of the curved motion of bodies such as planets and virtually everything that we're familiar with, even galaxies rotating and so on, wasn't caused by a force called gravity, but rather by the curvature of space caused by mass itself. And I think we're probably all vaguely familiar with that. And his theory was that massive bodies, very massive bodies, for example, dense stars, actually bend space around them. And so that an object approaching and about to go by a massive object would actually be deflected, not because of the force of gravity, which he didn't think existed, but rather because of the curvature of space in around the massive object. Well, this was a great theory, and that was terrific and so on, but how do you prove it? Well, the British astronomer Arthur Eddington had an idea, and the idea was that if you could observe stars very close to our sun, then with the starlight coming right by the sun, the curvature of space would be enough that if you could observe the starlight, the stars would appear to be shifted outwards just a little bit. Now, I think we probably all know that from reading some astronomy history, but what I didn't realize until recently is the amount of the predicted deflection at the sun's surface would be 1/2000th of a degree. 1/2000th of a degree out. So it required very careful measurements. The problem is, of course, that the sun is reasonably bright, and you can't see stars anywhere close to it, except during a total eclipse of the sun. And so in 1919, there was a total eclipse that was visible in Brazil and then went across the Atlantic Ocean and across an island, Presepe, right off Africa. And so there were expeditions that were mounted to photograph the star field around the eclipsed sun in order to determine from those plates whether, in comparison with previous plates taken 6 months earlier that showed the same star field, the stars actually did in fact appear to be deflected. Now, it turned out that in Brazil they were almost totally clouded and rained out, and the weather wasn't actually all that good off Africa as well, but they did get some plates, not an awful lot. And they measured the plates, and the reported results were that, yes, indeed, the stars did appear to be deflected. So much so that the Astronomer Royal in England published in the news, Newton was wrong, Einstein was right. Well, this was right at the end of World War I. And of course, the English fancied themselves as having won that war. And there's a lot of suspicion about those results and about that declaration. Part of it as well, frankly, the historians believe, is that Einstein was of Germanic descent and the Germans had lost the war. So how could you believe anything that a German had predicted at that time? One of the other things, however, was that the results were a little inconsistent. And in fact, on some of the plates, the stars actually seemed to have been deflected inward and not outward. So not everybody was convinced. However, 3 years later, there was going to be a great solar eclipse where the weather was bound to be good. And this was in 1922. And so this was an eclipse that started off in the Indian Ocean, well, actually just off Africa, went south of India, south of Indonesia, and then crossed Australia, starting in the northwest. And a number of expeditions were mounted to go to see this eclipse and to take big, fancy, large, so-called Einstein cameras that had been designed, developed, and built to try to take these photographs. And what happened is that one of the astronomers actually went to Tahiti many months before and took comparison plates of the star field in the constellation Taurus that would then be used as the comparator plates. And when he finished there, he went to Australia actually to see the eclipse. So he spent many, many months there. This was the decisive so-called Einstein eclipse. And it was a little place called Wawel, South Africa, South Australia. There was no road there. It was most famous for a murder having been committed there many years earlier, but it required some real logistics to get there. And a number of expeditions went to South Australia. The South Australian government, because scientists were coming from all over the world, put on great feasts and so on and celebrations. And there was a train that crossed from Sydney all the way across to the West Coast with politicians and the scientists. And this eclipse was in September. They arrived near the beginning of August in order to set all of this up. It was almost like a Himalayan mountain expedition. And there were four main expeditions to Wawel, and then some others not quite as consequential to other areas. Three of them, Lick Observatory and the Perth Observatory. Lick Observatory, of course, in the United States, and Perth Observatory from Perth in Western Australia, and then an observatory in India. But there was a fourth expedition, and that is an expedition from the University of Toronto. And what is really interesting is that back then, the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada made a donation of $1,500 to the University of Toronto to mount and partly fund this expedition. So the RSC had a hand in all of this. And the expedition was under the tutelage of Dr. Clarence A. Chant, a member of the RASC, for whom the Chant Medal of the RASC is named. I should say, this was a picture not actually taken at the eclipse site. He didn't wear those clothes, but Dr. Chant was well known in the society and still is greatly revered. And he led the expedition of University of Toronto astronomers. And so what they had to do is commandeer, and this was done by the Australian Parliament, a navy vessel. They actually had to have two vessels, one for the equipment and one for the astronomers, to tow down from the northern part. The tides here amounted to about 9 meters, so it took a long time to get all of the equipment actually on shore. And there were local natives, Aborigines, as they called themselves and still do there, who A, assisted, and B, were interested in watching what was going on. They lugged it all ashore and then had mule teams to take it all inland to where they had decided that they were going to set up and construct their an observatory. And so here was a 40-foot Einstein camera that they were erecting, and this took a lot of time. You can see filming there in the lower left-hand corner. This was a big deal, pouring concrete piers and so on. And anybody who's been to Australia knows they had problems with dust and flies constantly and a lot of heat. Here they are with some other equipment, several different cameras. And what was really interesting is that there were a number of women astronomers, and they all had to wear long dresses because that was appropriate eclipse garb back then. And you can see that. So here's one of the Einstein cameras. I'm not sure, the guy has a mallet there. I don't know whether he's banging the lens in there, but this is one of the Einstein cameras, and you can see the mesh that they're wearing over their heads because of the constant flies. And then we have the University of Toronto team. And you can see then down and at the bottom there, the solar eclipse, various scenes and so on, Corona, University of Toronto. And then you see a little sticker right on the box there that says CA Chant. So these are University of Toronto astronomers with their stuff. And they also have a little cafe. And as you can see, they called it Cafe Einstein. He actually was not there, but they named it in his honor. And it was very successful. And so here is one of the glass plates, and there are a lot of stars shown here. You can't just see them all that well. But in fact, the results were excellent for this eclipse. And indeed, the deflections of the stars were all in the right direction, and indeed by the predicted amounts. And so this eclipse really was the one that determined or proved that, yes, indeed, Einstein had been correct. And so it's a pretty famous eclipse. And so these, and the reason I want to show these is these were professional eclipse expeditions. And yes, some amateurs tagged along, but there really wasn't the concept of amateur astronomer solar eclipse expeditions back then. That started to come a lot later. Dr. Chant, in fact, wrote an article in the Journal of the RASC in January, February 1923 when he talked about this, the eclipse camp at Wallal. A very interesting article indeed. And so we now get into modern times, and this then I want to get into the 1960s, in sort of the decade before many of us. I don't know, Ralph, when did you join the society? 1970. All right, the same year as I did then, Ralph. And so we probably, I think probably had both read about, and Randy, you were a member around that time too. Same year, okay. All of us, 90s. It was a great vintage, And we were all aware of solar eclipses from the previous decade. And of course, we'd either A, been, in short pants in grade school, or B, without money to actually go to these things. And so taking a look at some the North American total solar eclipses of the 60s and 70s, the first great one was July in 1963. That was a short eclipse, but it was a summer eclipse and therefore fairly good weather. And in fact, it was seen. There may be some people out there, and I know that there are a couple here tonight, who will remember a former president of the Toronto Centre, Anne Scott. Anne Scott, as it turned out, I learned when I made her acquaintance and became friends, was married on that day, but not in the path of totality. So that was a great eclipse, but you know, not a lot of people actually traveled to see that. Some did, but not an awful lot. Then there was the great March 1970 solar eclipse, which crossed Mexico and then went up the eastern seaboard of the U.S. And that eclipse was at that time the most widely observed solar eclipse ever, because of the population centers within the path of totality and within a very short drive of that, even though it was March and the weather actually turned out to be fairly good. I got interested in astronomy just a few months after that, and so I did not see that solar eclipse, but it's a well-known and renowned eclipse. Then we get to the July 1972 eclipse. Now, this is an eclipse that three of us in this room, Ralph Chu, president of the Toronto Center, and Randy Attwood, and I went to see. That is the first total solar eclipse that I went to see, and I think maybe first one for you two as well. Your third? All right, Ralph's third. And it was the first one I went to see, and the first one, and the only one that I have been totally clouded out of. And I went to the Gaspé Peninsula to see that. The Toronto Centre organized a bus expedition with the Ontario Science Centre, where we are here tonight, to go down to Bonaventure, New Brunswick, where I, well, as I say, we were cloud out, where I was, you know, NASA was there with its van and telescopes and so on. And the day started out fine, just a little bit of cloud, but it was, this was an afternoon eclipse, a fairly late afternoon eclipse. And I didn't know it at the time, but certainly we now know that in the summertime, the afternoon side of the eclipse, of a total solar eclipse, is not where you want to be. You want to be there in the morning, because clouds form in the afternoon and not in the morning, and you're much more likely to get clouded out in the afternoon. And I didn't know that, but as the afternoon wore on and we were all, you know, getting ready, and the partial phase started and I could see the partial phase, the cloud got denser and denser and denser and denser, and it got dark, but I saw nothing. And I had been planning that thing for 2 years and was totally crushed and in a bad mood for around 6 years after that. And partly it was because, you know, partway through university, and I knew that the next chance I would get to see a solar eclipse would not probably be for another 7 years, till 1979, because that was the next time the moon's shadow would cross North America. And so, you know, I went on to do other things, join the RASC and so on, and became a member of the Toronto Centre. At one point, National Council Rep and Treasurer and so on. All of us have been involved in the governance of the centre. And so here was the 1979 eclipse. And this path was very wide. I don't want you to think, oh, gee, that, you know, that must have been a really, really long eclipse. No, no, no. The width of the path really, as it's shown on a map, does not indicate anything really generally about the duration of the eclipse. Very often it is caused by, with a low elevation eclipse in the winter, the shadow coming in at an oblique angle, and so the path of totality may be very wide as it's projected on Earth's surface, but that doesn't actually give any indication of how long the eclipse is going to be. And as you can see, the 1979 one, at its maximum, was 2 minutes 49 seconds of totality. So less than 1970, but more than 1963, certainly. And so we get to this eclipse. And so here was the path of totality for this eclipse. And as you can see, the total phase started off in the Pacific Ocean. And here we see that when the moon's shadow first struck, just at dawn in the Pacific Ocean, the length of the total phase was a minute and 49 seconds. 8 minutes later, when the shadow struck terra firma, the length of totality had increased to 2 minutes and 13 seconds. And then at the Idaho-Montana border, it was up to 2 minutes 30 seconds, where it crossed into Canada, 2 minutes 45 seconds. And then the greatest eclipse then was 2 minutes 49 seconds. And as the shadow then went into the afternoon part of the eclipse, the length of totality then decreased until the shadow left Earth's surface over Greenland. And So the local times here for the eclipse, it started at a little bit after 8 a.m. In the morning. And then yes, I guess actually it was only 5 minutes later when the shadow struck terra firma. Then we had one time zone shift, but then 9 minutes later, it was crossing from Idaho into Montana. We then get there 17 minutes later, it crosses into Canada. And then at the point of greatest eclipse, it was 10:54, so just about 11 o'clock in the morning, and then into noon and into the afternoon. And so the moon's shadow then, as it raced across, this is the actual shape of the shadow and how fast it was going at that point. So it was it's a circular shadow, obviously, in space, but it was projected on a very on an oblique surface of the Earth, which is why you get that long ellipse, and which explains why the path on Earth's surface is so apparently so wide. And as the sun gets higher in the sky, and you get closer to the noon point, where the sun is right on the meridian facing due south, the shadow gets wider, and it compresses into slightly more circular shape. So this is actually the shape of the shadow at that instant as it was on the planet, right? And as well, the speed of the shadow actually across Earth's surface is decreasing from 2 kilometers a second down to 784 meters per second at the greatest point. And then it starts to increase again and the shadow gets elongated. At this eclipse, there were several cities that were fairly close. Portland was right in the path. Seattle just outside. Helena, Montana, almost on the center line. Brandon, Manitoba, was almost right on the center line. And Winnipeg was about 60% of the way to the edge of the shadow. And Regina missed. But where we ended up going was the little town of Gimli, Manitoba. And there's a whole story about that. And what I'm going to say is I just recently, in finally looking at old files, I found the original contract. And what happened here is this. As went through the 1970s and my bad mood started to dissipate, as we got into 1977 and 78, I thought, I got to get to this eclipse. How are we going to do it? I was involved with the Toronto Centre. We need to do a Toronto Centre expedition. So I approached Toronto Centre Council. I think I was probably on council at that point, and said, I want to mount an expedition. And council said, fine, sure, what do you need? Answer, money. So I got $2,000. And what we decided to do was to try to charter aircraft to fly us to this eclipse. Now, I'm going back over my old papers. I've forgotten some of this. I first approached Air Canada, and Air Canada said, I'm not sure whether it was still TCA, Trans-Canada Airlines back then, or Air Canada, I forget, but Air Canada said, well, we don't know at this point. We'll let you know. Ultimately, Air Canada said no after we'd already sold half the tickets and collected all the money from people. And we were telling them that it was going to cost somewhere between $100 and $200. And so, toward the end of 1978 and getting, within just a couple of months of the eclipse, sort of having to scramble, I found this company called Worldways, which was a small charter aircraft airline out of Malton, and they had a couple of aircraft, Convair 640 aircraft, that would be able to take us. And so this was their standard form contract, but then there's a whole bunch of stuff that I drafted and they agreed to, some of which you will see. And so what you'll see here, this is the contract, and what you'll see here is that's the date I actually signed it with them in at their office in Malton. So this is a month and a half actually before the eclipse. We'd sold out, we had all the money, only then did we actually have the contract signed. And these were the two aircraft with a total of 102 people. We actually ended up jamming a few more in. And that was the price for the two aircraft for an entire day. The idea was, we'd fly earlier in the morning, fly out. The idea was that we wanted to go to Winnipeg. That turned out not to be feasible. We ended up in Gimli. And there's the old Toronto Centre seal. And so this is some stuff this is what I wrote up, and you know what they agreed to. And as you can see from paragraph two there, we said that we would tell them when we were airborne where we were going to land, where we wanted to land. And they agreed to that. And that would depend on the weather, just like you would get now, right? And so they agreed to that. Let me just give you a minute to read this. So if it was cloudy, they agreed that they would take off and fly along the path of totality so we could see it airborne above the clouds. Well, there's a whole story about that as well. So, and they agreed to all of this, which was great. And so this now then is that sort of the lead up to what happened and to the eclipse. And Randy's now going to take over. But I'll just say that some of you who are watching, there are a few people here tonight, but we have terrible weather in Toronto, so it's not a huge crowd. But there are probably some people, there may be some people watching this who actually were on that expedition. And there are a lot of names that will be familiar to old-time Toronto Centre members, in addition to Ralph and Randy. Ian McGregor worked at the McLaughlin Planetarium and was the captain of the second aircraft. People like Ann Scott, president of the Centre, John Morris, Jim Cobbin, Richard McWaters, and a lot of people who are very familiar to us. And we got some people as well from the U.S. And also, and you'll see a couple of photographs, first time I actually had met him, and it turned out to be his first solar eclipse. He'd never seen one before. A fellow, some of you might have heard his name, a fellow by the name of Terence Dickinson, who came on our expedition. He'd never seen a solar eclipse before. And this was his first time to try to see one. So we're going to stop now, and we'll continue this later. But Randy, it's now time, I think, for the video. And let me just say, Randy won't say very much about this. He started this project a long time ago. And this is, it took an enormous amount of work. All of the original slides had to be scanned. All the dust gotten rid of and all of that in order to produce any kind of workable images at all. Now, when you see this, please remember, what Randy has tried to do is completely remastered it and turned it to video. The sound quality is way better. You're going to hear his recording actually during totality. And so this does reflect what we were able to do as amateurs in the Toronto Centre 40 years ago. It is not a slick current production, but we hope that it will give you some idea of the drama. And you will undoubtedly also recognize some of the music that was au courant back then. So, Randy?
Thanks, Michael. Okay, here, do the switcheroo. There's the noiseroo. One very short video here, and there's sound.
The 2,000 meter airstrip at Gimli, although uncontrolled, is the second longest.
So let me just pause it. So this, back in 1983, when I hosted a Cable 10 astronomy show, I had Ralph and Michael on a 1-hour show. We were talking about total eclipses. And I asked Michael to essentially run this particular slideshow. There are three slide projectors, one with an image to the left, one with an image to the right, and a third one, which when it had a slide, because it would have a black slide in it at this point, when it had a real slide in it, it would show a full image, and you'll see that in a minute. So the person operating this is playing the tape recorder and then has a script, and they essentially they've got three slide controllers, and they need to hit them all at the right time. So that took a lot of practice, and Michael did it for the TV camera. So that's why it's not the greatest image, because it's sort of a TV image of the slide screen, and then this is a copy of a copy or whatever. But I wanted to show you what the original looked like.
Public strip in the province, and was ideal for landing the two Convair 640 aircraft that the center had chartered. We had arranged with the Space Research Department of the National Research Council to use a large heated hangar to keep our bodies and our equipment warm. In order to make final arrangements, I visited the site in January and met the manager of the airfield, Colonel James Dunlop. I also had the rare opportunity to meet the friendly residents of Gimli, who appeared well-dressed for the cold.
Okay, so in fact, the audio of the Eclipse that you hear was the original on the tape. So there was a cassette tape that went along. I really tried to keep as close to the original format and not stray too much. The people that worked on this was, did you work on it with?
Oh, yeah.
So you and Andreas and Richard McWaters. And so the people that worked on it, they are in the credits, and all the people who supplied slides and whatever. I did very little to modify the format, except I did not want to have the two slides going back and forth. I wanted to have highest definition of images and highest definition of music. I added one or two little themes here and there, but tried to be as true as possible. Well, the way I did it was I actually worked in to that Astronomy Toronto tape, so I had all of the images available and the music and the narration, and then essentially I just overlaid with better quality pictures and music. The only thing I couldn't use was Michael's narration, because that was on top of the audio track. So I had to type out a script for him, and I bugged him for several months as this date got closer and closer. He signed the contract in January, and he actually did the narration in early January, believe it or not. So this is brand new narration, and I hope you enjoy Flight to Totality. Oh, no.
The Toronto Centre's solar eclipse expedition, 13 months in the planning, culminated with an eclipse preparation meeting 3 nights before eclipse day. 100 observers filled the lecture theatre at the Royal Ontario Museum to hear members of the Solar Eclipse Committee and the observers group explain eclipse observation techniques. A scant 60 hours later, the last total solar eclipse visible in Canada in the 20th century would begin. The moon's shadow would touch down on the Earth's surface 1,500 kilometers west of Vancouver Island in the Pacific Ocean. Racing eastward, the shadow would strike land south of Seattle 8 minutes later. The path of totality then would curve northward and would enter Canada at the Saskatchewan-Manitoba border. The Interlake region of Manitoba, northeast of Winnipeg, would be the best observing site for this eclipse. The moon's shadow, apparently elliptical when drawn on a map, is actually circular in space and is merely projected on the inclined surface of the Earth. In order to avoid the expected traffic jam of eclipse observers at Brandon and Winnipeg, the Toronto Centre decided to observe at Gimli, Manitoba, where the total phase of the eclipse would last 2 minutes 48 seconds, only 3 seconds less than on the centre line. The 2,000-metre airstrip at Gimli, although uncontrolled, is the second longest public strip in the province and was ideal for landing the two Convair 640 aircraft that the Toronto Centre had chartered. We had arranged with the Space Research Department of the National Research Council to use a large heated hangar to keep our bodies and our equipment warm. In order to make final arrangements, I visited the site in January and met the manager of the airfield, Colonel James Dunlop. I also had the rare opportunity to meet the friendly residents of Gimli, who appeared well-dressed for the cold. The day of my site preview trip was perfect, with clear blue skies and a temperature of minus 25 degrees Celsius. I only hoped that Eclipse Day would be the same. Mr. Dunlop suggested that we plan to set up our equipment right on the tarmac, and I determined that the taxiway pointed directly to where the sun would be located at Totality. We also went out to the airport at Malton to inspect the aircraft for seating and equipment storage. At long last, all was ready, and we arranged to meet at the hangar at 3 o'clock a.m. two nights later. During the 30 hours before the eclipse, concern was caused by news of a large snowstorm approaching Manitoba from the Northwest Territories. Shortly after we landed at Gimli, thin cirrus clouds moved over the entire sky, and a decision had to be made whether to observe totality airborne or on the ground. Our pilots had contacted air controllers at Brandon, who had told them that the cirrus cloud was at 30,000 feet, higher than our aircraft could fly. An announcement was made, a vote taken, and all 106 observers elected to take a chance and stay on the ground.
Quiet over there, eh?
Look at all the structure in the corona. It's a fantastic corona.
Sunset colors all around.
Take a look in the telescope here, quick.
Okay, right, look.
Pink prominence, quick. John?
Quick, Mikey.
How long?
Don't worry, sir. Let's tell us.
All right.
Quick.
Just
quick. Quick.
I'm sorry.
Excuse me, please. Excuse me. David? Oh, it's up right now. Don't touch me. Please move back. Please move back. One person at a time.
Totality's mostly over now.
God, Michael, there's a prominence there. Prominence is there.
Look at the
moon. That's the moon. New moon. The newest day.
Whoa, Michael, they are gorgeous.
Yeah, watch the diamond ring.
Can you tell us when the diamond ring is going to be?
It's very clear.
Oh, wow. The prominent says woo!
Take your last foot!
Prominent says...
Nobody got on.
Wow, yeah. That's...
Holy Jesus, that's unbelievable. Hey, look, there's a shadow coming over us. Look, it's lightning out over there. See it?
Oh, I see.
There it goes!
Ben, get ready!
Beautiful. Hold your thumb over.
So good.
So good.
Of an unforgettable experience. And to remind us of the perpetual movement of the heavens, the next evening the crescent moon and Mercury made a brief appearance in the western sky, filling us with the anticipation of next year's rendezvous with the lunar shadow at the Toronto Center's expedition to observe the 4-minute eclipse in East Africa.
Are you distressed? Are you safe?
So we just have to get the PowerPoint back up. Press Escape first, I think.
Oh,
right, right, and then Control F5. Yep. Okay. All right. So I another round of applause for Randy's work on that. I think as well. It You know, he's been working on it, well, actually, ever since 1979. And it's really well worthwhile, I think, as you can see. So let's just go forward now a little bit. We'll just move on. Okay, I should have gone through all of this. All right, but let's then go forward from there, because this, you know, this was a pretty big deal for the Toronto Centre. And the one after that in 1980, you heard that discuss at the end, the Toronto Centre put on an expedition. I was originally involved in that and was going to go on it until just a few months before the 1980 expedition, when my car was broken into and all of my camera equipment was stolen. And so I had to decide, am I going to replace my camera equipment or go on the Eclipse? And I decided to replace the camera equipment. And so Randy and Ralph and others went on the 1981. And I thought that what I would do is, some of you, perhaps many of you, will know Randy's wife, Betty, who's a Toronto Centre member for a long time and was involved in publishing Scope for many years. And some of you will have met my wife, Helen, and together we have been to see an awful lot of eclipses. And this was the one in Kenya in 1980. It was a long eclipse, almost 4 minutes from where the Toronto Centre observed it in Voi in Kenya. And then in 1983, I went to Indonesia to see the great 5-minute eclipse in June of that year. I had the good fortune to meet Patrick Moore at our eclipse site, and then I went on to Australia and spent some time at the Australian Observatory and did some photography there. And then a Toronto Centre expedition in 1984 to see the great beaded annular eclipse, which was a real treat, and there's an entire story and one of Randy's productions on Astronomy Toronto about that particular eclipse, which you can look up on YouTube. But the interesting thing about that eclipse, this was an interesting one, and Ralph, you were on that, I'm sure. And so this is a very interesting eclipse, because it was sort of an annular eclipse, but it was, you know, with a ring of sunlight left around around the moon. But the moon was almost but not quite big enough to cover the entire sun. However, mountains on the edge of the moon all the way around broke up the tiny razor-thin ring into diamonds all the way around. And so it was called, instead of the diamond ring, it was called the diamond necklace. Now, this is a really unusual eclipse, and it's very unusual, A, to have them at all, but B, to have them over land. 18 years earlier, at the previous eclipse in this Saros cycle, which was an almost identical eclipse, that one was observed from Greece. And when this one was coming up and we decided to organize an expedition, a bus expedition, I went back to the old Sky and telescopes to read all about that eclipse, because I was really curious. Did we stand any chance of actually seeing the corona, even though the entire photosphere of the sun would never be covered at any time? Would enough of it be covered that we would be able to see any of the corona? So I went back to 1963 and read all the articles, and Dennis DiCicco and Joseph Ashbrook and all of the you know, well-known Sky and Telescope people and astronomers and observers, and none of them had seen the corona at that time. But then I read the accounts of how they went about trying to do it, and they all described trying to look for the corona right at the mid-eclipse, when there were diamonds all the way around. And I said to myself, that's the wrong time to be looking. You don't look at mid-eclipse. You look 20 seconds before on one side with the uneclipsed sun on the other, and then 20 seconds after mid-eclipse on the other side. So I said, that is the way to do it in my view. And we tried that. That's a whole story in itself. And we succeeded, where the corona had never been seen. So we saw the corona in 1984 in May. So we knew that there was going to be another total solar eclipse in November of that year. As it turns out, and I think probably most people know this, you cannot have two total solar eclipses in succession. If you have a total solar eclipse, the next one's going to be annular or partial. And only if you get a beaded annular can you then have a total eclipse. And as a result, never before in history had the corona ever been seen at two successive solar eclipses. But because we had managed to see the corona at the beaded annular eclipse, we thought if we can get to Papua New Guinea 6 months from now, we might do something that no one in history had ever done before, and that is see the corona at two successive eclipses. And so, in November of 1984, we went to Papua New Guinea to see the 54-second eclipse. And Betty and Randy and I and some other people went there. And that was a very early morning eclipse. We were successful, by the way, and as a result, we are the only people ever in history to have seen the corona at two successive solar eclipses. So 1987, this is one that Helen and I went to in Gabon. It was a 3 second annular eclipse, and then we went on to Egypt and so on. So that was a pretty short one. And then in 1988, this was one that that we were on, and you'll see a couple of photographs. Randy was really instrumental in organizing that trip. That was a really interesting one in the southern island of Mindanao. Then in 1991, the great long eclipse. Lots of members of the RASC and various centers had expeditions to the mainland of Mexico. We went to Baja California. Randy and I were co-expedition leaders for the RASC Center. We chartered a jet aircraft, and it took 2 full years to plan that entire eclipse, but we saw that great long eclipse from Baja California. And then in 1994, this is one that I went to see. It was actually in Ohio. It was a long 6 minute annular eclipse. And then in 1994, I went to see one in the Atacama, very high elevation. We were up at not quite, but almost 5,000 meters where the air was very thin. And as a result of that, because the low oxygen, a good friend of ours actually got all befuddled and forgot to load film into his camera. And so he took all of his photographs and all of that, opened it up later, no film in the camera. And it was because of oxygen deprivation. Anyway, we saw that one, and that was pretty great. Then Randy and Betty saw one from the, I didn't see this one, saw one from the Galapagos Islands. As it turns out, it was a 4 minute eclipse. It was on the anniversary, February 26th, of the great 1979 eclipse. So they had a great time with their daughter, Beth. And then in 1999, we all hooked up, Betty and Randy and Helen and I and their daughter, Beth, and we saw an eclipse. There's a great story about that. There are great stories for all of these eclipses north of Paris. And then in 2006, Betty and Randy saw an eclipse from Turkey. I didn't see that one. And then, of course, everybody in the world, or at least in North America, saw the 2017 eclipse. And so these are the eclipses that we have seen since the 1979 eclipse, the blue ones being total and the red ones being annular. And so in just the last little bit of this, this was February of 1980, the one I did not go on, but Randy's provided me with some photos, and this was the one from East Africa that the Toronto Centre went to in Kenya. It was a late, early morning eclipse, the Toronto Centre expedition, and that was a pretty long one. So here they are set up. In the heat, and the obligatory post-eclipse, I actually don't have any photographs of Totality, but the Toronto Centre banner and the obligatory group photo afterwards. I don't think they, you can see also the obligatory bottles of champagne, which you always have to have if you, in fact, see the corona. Then in 1988, this was a really good eclipse that we saw, as I say, from the Philippines, from General Santos City in Mindanao, where there had been a lot of, and still is a lot of insurgency, and the Philippine government had sent the military down there to take care of and keep safe all of the eclipse observers. And we, as I say, saw it from, this was an early, fairly early morning eclipse, as well, and we saw it from Mindanao. And that was a pretty decent length, 3 minutes, 19 seconds. There, Betty and Randy in somewhat younger days, and somewhat, not as fancy equipment as we now have, because, it was a long time ago. And again, the Toronto Centre eclipse banner, the Canadian flags that we always take with us. No, we're not American. Yes, the latitude, and you can see that from the way the telescope is set. It's almost pointing straight up because we're so close to the equator, and that makes it very, very tricky. When you see a high altitude eclipse at any latitude, for example, the August 2017 one, for those of us who were in Nebraska, for example, and even a little further east, it was really high, and that presents its own challenges. And here are our Helen and me beside the 5-inch refractor that I had taken to that one. Oh, there seems to be a big bottle of beer there. It was a hot day. And the thing is, and you know what's really interesting? We saw it, and Randy reminded me the clouds came in partly through totality, but there's a lot of cloud in the sky. But we saw the eclipse and got some, you know, okay photographs as well. And so that's from 1988. And these are all slides that have been scanned in the interim. And then in August of 1999, as I say, we went to north of Paris to see this eclipse. And this was a very well-observed eclipse as well, and a really good one. We were north of Paris, 90 kilometers. So it wasn't that long an eclipse, just a little over 2 minutes. What was really interesting is that the morning of the eclipse, we were staying in a town called Beauvais, and then we had scouted out an observing site at a little town, you know, probably about 30, 35, something like that, kilometers north. Well, we got onto the auto route and came up over a crest, and it just stopped. And there's nothing but a jam, a lineup of cars, and they just stopped, kind of crawling forward. So I said to Helen, "Listen, you get out, hop in, you drive the car." And I got out, and I went back to the car and just kind of walked along beside and said, "You know, what are we going to do?" And because we couldn't move, and we're, you know, a long way from our observing site, and we had our filters with us, we were looking up. The partial phase had already started. Damn it, what are we going to do? So I finally said, "This is stupid. We're never going to get to our observing site." So I said to Randy, "This is what I'm going to do. You can do whatever you want." I pulled over to the side of the road. Far in the side of the road, there's a big embankment. We just took out our equipment, and we set right up there. Well, as soon as we did, everybody did. Then the gendarme came. And what they told us was, not you're going to jail, but just make sure you pull way off the road, and good luck. And then they went on their way. And so here we are, set up. And this was actually after the eclipse. And so Betty and Helen and their daughter Beth. And this was Beth's second eclipse, right? Because she went to the Galapagos, Randy? Yeah. 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 And so we had to observe in French, of course. And that was a pretty great eclipse. And what was really amazing is, as it turned out, it was really, really cloudy. And then just before totality, a big hole came right across. We saw the entire thing. Then the hole moved off, and it turned cloudy again. And if we managed to make it to our observing site, we would have been clouded out. So as it turned out, it was very, very lucky. And then, of course, the great 2017 eclipse that a lot of people here probably saw. And, you know, the most widely observed eclipse ever in history, for sure. No doubt about it. The so-called Great American Eclipse. It was sort of, you know, making America great again. And so Benny Randy went to Idaho on a trip. Ralph, as I recall, you were near Seattle, weren't you? Sorry? Right. And Helen and I and our two kids were in western Nebraska. So that was a 2-minute, 30-second eclipse. We hadn't seen one actually in a long time. And this is kind of interesting. And so this was where a lot of people went, mainly because of the weather. And Benny and Randy were on an expedition that sort of a commercial one that started off in Wyoming and in around Jackson Hole. And then because of weather and various things, they decided the expedition decided the day before the eclipse, I think it was, to go across the border into Idaho. And so that's where they observed the eclipse, right up over the Teton Mountain range. And we were in western Nebraska. We'd actually been in the center of Nebraska in Grand Island. And I'd been looking at the weather the day before, and it looked like it was going to be really terrible. So we got, well, I actually got up at 1 in the morning, checked the weather again, and it looked bad. Got everybody up. We left at 4 in the morning and drove 450 kilometers to western Nebraska through the fog. The fog cleared off, burned off at 9 a.m. It was a completely blue sky because the front had come through, and we saw the eclipse in probably the best conditions I've ever had. And so the distance between where we were was 625 kilometers, and this was the path. So we were both pretty much on the center line. That was the shape of the shadow. And so the shadow came first over, you know, Betty and Randy, so they saw the eclipse, and it was all over, and I think they were drinking beer before the eclipse had even happened for us. And so how long do you think it took the shadow to travel that 625 kilometers between our observing sites? Any guesses here? How long? 5 minutes? Anybody else? Thirteen minutes and 28 seconds. And so on average, at this point in the eclipse path, not the beginning, not at the end, but at this point in the eclipse path, the average speed was, I recalculated this, Randy, 773 meters a second, a little less, well, three quarters of a kilometer per second. Yeah, very close to the Gimli speed, absolutely. All right, and so, there's a different perspective. Randy managed to dig this one up. We didn't go here to observe, but this is a satellite image of the shadow crossing North America. And you can see that as the weather predictions had been, it was quite clear through almost all of western North America. And surprisingly, even into Tennessee, where a lot of people went, but the weather predictions had not been actually all that good. So it turned out to be a very lucky day for most people in North America. And so Betty and Randy were here in Idaho, and as you could see, you know, because of the heat and so on, and only because of the heat, they were thirsty. And so this is Randy's. And another one, good prominences at this eclipse. And one thing about this eclipse is that the sun happened to be in Leo and happened to be just a very few degrees from the bright star Regulus. And so I had given some information and so on about how people could photograph the eclipse sun and Regulus in one frame. And Randy managed to get this one, which was pretty neat. And then right at the end of the eclipse, the diamond ring at the end. And so then to get to western Nebraska where we were, and here's my family after after the eclipse. We'd taken two cars and driven all the way out actually from Toronto. And that was my gear. A couple of telescopes and another camera. And so those are my photos of diamond ring at the beginning and at the end. Nice prominences. I really like this photo. This was in the December 2017 Sky News. And then again, just a slightly different view, but the eclipse sun and Regulus again. And then what I think is, a little collage there. And then I think my favorite shot from this eclipse. There's a lot of structure in that corona, and the polar brushes were really quite phenomenal. So that was a pretty terrific eclipse. And then the next ones that we're going to go to, Helen and I are going to be in western Argentina this coming July in the depths of winter, but it won't be actually all that cold for the 2-minute 30-second eclipse. And then I think Betty and Randy are thinking of going and may very well go to the December 2020 eclipse. We are still, you know, sort of undecided, but really interesting. You know, two eclipses there within a year and a half of each other, both crossing Chile and Argentina. So those are our next adventures, and we'll see what happens. And then, of course, we have the great 2024 eclipse that people have been talking about already. And as I think we all know, it crosses Niagara Falls. Misses both Toronto and Mississauga by a bit, but the you know, and so there's a great temptation to think, oh gee, we'll just go down the road, visit the wineries and the Niagara Bench, go to the Eclipse, but it's April, and the chances are that the weather will be terrible. So we've already decided we're going to be in Texas for sure for that Eclipse. Anyway, there we are. Thank you very much. I don't know what the time is. Okay. So listen, I'm not necessarily going to ask for questions, but maybe comments, observations, because there are people here who have seen eclipses, and anything anybody might want to say would be just fine. Or if there are any questions, then that'd be fine too. Anybody at all? One right up in the back. Just getting the microphone passed there.
In the pictures from Gimli where you had the whole background and everything, it looked like the sun was full, like it was at totality, but it was just one white disk. I'm wondering what effect that was.
One big white blob?
Correct.
Yes, okay. So that is simply an artifact of the long exposure that's required to get the very dark foreground actually to show some people in the foreground. And so the corona's burned in, and because it was a very wide-angle lens, and my guess is that that was either a 24 or 35 millimeter lens, the size of the sun actually on the film plane is only about a millimeter and a half, and so the flaring and so on from the corona fills in the dark black disk of the moon. That's what you're seeing. Okay, anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
Once you got to Gimli, how long did it take you to get set up, because you left early in the morning and the eclipse wasn't that much later?
Well, it wasn't. That's a really good question. We had to stop in Winnipeg actually to refuel. And so that took some time as well. But we had left at 4 in the morning. No, there were prop planes. And so we had landed in Winnipeg around 7:30, filled up quickly, and then got to Gimli. So I think that we had, for sure, somewhere, I'm going to say, around an hour and a half or so, maybe even a little longer. And I think that people were set up actually before the partial phase actually even started. Now, the big problem with that, though, is that it was so damn cold. And, of course, there were no digital cameras. There were film cameras. And so we set up fairly close to the hangar. We could get into the hangar. I kept my cameras in there and one camera inside my parka, because the cold would mean that when you wound the film, it would just snap, and people had that happen. And that was a big problem, and I'd anticipated that. So I had my cameras ready, ran in about 4 minutes before totality, had them already focused, ready to go, came out, stuck them on. They started cooling down, but I was able to wind the film and get the photos. So there were a lot of things to think about.
Just a couple of quick anecdotes. I went to Gabon in 2013 for the hybrid eclipse.
Oh, yes.
Okay, and so we had the same problem that you had at one of your eclipses, where it was cloudy. But then the witch doctor came, sun came out, the eclipse, we got a full, beautiful eclipse, clouds came back.
Good for you. Good for you. So often, it's the other way around.
This is a question from online, and it seems like you just answered it. Can you talk about the solar films that you used in 1979? So thank you for that.
Yeah, all right. So the question is what film did we use? And I think I used a couple at that time. The thing is that the inner corona is quite bright. And so you are absolutely able, with short exposures, and I'm talking about 125th of a second, 60th of a second, 15th of a second, to use something like Velvia ISO 50, or ectochrome, which was 160, not high-speed ectochrome, which was 1600, or Kodachrome, either 25 or 64. And you could absolutely use those to get the inner corona. A longer exposure, even with those very slow speeds of up to to a second, and you can get middle to outer corona. So you did not have to use, for example, high-speed echochrome at ISO 1600. You could use much slower and finer grain film. And that translates now into our modern, our digital cameras. We call them ISO speeds. Well, they're not really that. It's electronic gain. But you use the same numbers. And so I think that I shot my Nebraska Eclipse photos at ISO 125, I believe. Randy, do you have any recollection of what you used? Yeah, in that range. Yeah, absolutely. But what you can do is you can check, because there are all sorts of eclipse exposure tables. Edmonton Center member of the RASC, Alan Dyer, who's a great astrophotographer, maybe the best in Canada, has a whole thing on that. And Fred, our buddy Fred Espinac, who's the world's greatest eclipse predictor, also has all of that. And you can see for your various F ratios and ISO speeds what the appropriate exposures are for diamond ring, for inner corona, for prominences, and then for outer corona.
One thing I tried in 2017, you might have seen that in that picture.
I had a laptop. I have a mic. Thanks.
Is that on?
Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
I had a laptop and some software which had a script, and it essentially took all the photos. I didn't touch the telescope during the entire eclipse, and it worked just perfectly.
So you'd really have to ask the computer.
How did I like it?
Anything else?
Yes, another question. What kind of solar filters did you guys use back then?
Back then, well, Randy, did you use? You must have had a solar filter of some kind, I'm sure.
Yeah,
Tuthill. Yeah, Roger Tuthill,
solar screen.
Yeah, what was called solar screen, and essentially it's the same kind of thing as is produced now, for example, by Kendrick in Toronto, and that is sort of a very thin, really optical quality a polymer, very thin, with metal coating. And you can get solid glass ones, Thousand Oaks, for example. I always had problems with them, but these ones are really good. You might think, how the heck can you get decent photographs, with this kind of wavy film that's blowing around in the wind, but it's really, really good quality, and so that's what we use, and they're also affordable.
Yeah, the 1972 eclipse may have been clouded out in Gaspé, but it was crystal clear in Halifax, which is where my dad observed and photographed it from the deck of the HMCS Saskatchewan.
Oh, is that right? Oh, my goodness. Well, a 72 eclipse. Okay, so, but did he write a song, and was it as famous as the one that we know from that eclipse? He wasn't so vain, was he?
No.
Oh, that's good. Okay, so not everybody was clouded out. I think there's one more in the back, and then maybe we'll, and then I think maybe it's time to wrap it up.
Comment and a question. The 2017 was the first total eclipse that I saw, and I was in Tennessee. We were viewing it from a park, a public park with picnic shelters, and what I realized you don't quite catch because your eyes adjust is how much darker it gets. So it looks like it's like continues to be the same brightness outside. And then I looked under the picnic shelter, and this is maybe 10 minutes before totality, and realized how dark it is under the shelter. You can't see a darn thing, and your eyes have been adjusting. I guess my question is, has anyone done a series of photos where you don't change the exposure and the ISO from start to finish? Because it's really quite dim, I guess, just before totality, but cameras tend to adjust and your eyes adjust and you don't quite notice it.
That's exactly what I did for the 72 eclipse when we were clouded out. So I just had a wide angle view, and I started at 1/125th and shot all the way through. And I've never, it's quite dramatic. Another thing I tried for 79 is I wore an eye patch for about a half an hour beforehand, and it was remarkable, the difference, how much more you could see. It was kind of neat. I looked really weird, but it was kind of neat.
Your comment and your observation actually are very interesting, and this is something that I thought about and then read a little bit about and then discovered, and that is that even if you're in the path of totality, You, and of course, the leading partial phase is usually about an hour and a half, a little less than that, an hour 20 minutes, and then totality, which will last anywhere from a few seconds to maximum about 6 minutes, 53 seconds or so, although there are no more of those in our lifetimes, and then about an hour 20 minutes partial phase again. And the thing that's really remarkable is as the moon moves across, and you know, when you get to 15 minutes before totality, when you've got about 80% or more than 80% of the sun covered, you don't really notice anything. You don't notice it getting darker. And that is, as you point out, because your eye is adjusting and your pupil is opening up until the point when it can't open up anymore. And then as the moon covers more, then you really start to see the darkness. And of course, that explains why in ancient times, people were taken by surprise because all of a sudden, bang, within about 3 minutes or so, it goes from what appears to be daylight to this great big hole in the sky. Well, no wonder. And they didn't have filters. So, you know, that is actually a really interesting phenomenon. Now, one thing that you do notice if you look carefully is that the shadows start to get weird, because what you'll do is, and particularly if it's a summer eclipse and you see the light coming through the leaves on trees, they make little pinhole cameras, you know, so you'll see all of these thousands of little crescents on the ground. And you also start to see the color balance change. It starts to become a little bit more silvery. Now, there are two reasons for that. One is that at that point, the cones in your eyes that are relatively light and sensitive but see color, there's not enough light anymore to trigger them, and so it's the rods that take over, and now all you can see is kind of gray tone. But the other is you're now seeing light from the edge of the sun rather from the center of the disk, and it's more yellow in the center of the disk, and it is a little grayer, bluer on the edge. And so the light actually coming through has a slightly different color balance as you get very close to totality. So those are some interesting observations. And I think that's just about it. So again, thank you very much on this winter night for coming, and I hope that you all get to see a total solar eclipse in your lifetimes. Thank you to our audience on remotely.